people often call me names. I've been called the dog shrink, the desi dog whisperer, and even the pagal pooch psychologist. Sometimes people ask me, do you work with crazy dogs all the time? And I tell people, in most of the cases, it's not the dogs that are crazy, it's the humans. I once had a very rich lady call me up about her little dog, Gucci. And she calls and she says, my Gucci is guarding the fridge and won't let us near it. So I said, why is your dog guarding the fridge? She says, well, his caviar is inside that and he doesn't want to share it with us. So it took me a second to recover and I told her, well, you need to bring the dog in for a consultation so we can sort out the problem. That's not happening, she tells me. My father thinks it's insulting for a dog to visit a shrink. And she hung up on me. A week later, she calls back and she says, hello, we don't need your help. We've sorted out the problem. I said, what did you do? That's amazing. How did you put right a biting dog in a week's time? She said, well, we just bought Gucci his own fridge. Now he guards that and he leaves ours alone. Another client of mine once came to me with a strange request. And she said, can you train my dog to push my mother-in-law off the balcony? They stayed on the 22nd floor. And for a second I said, I've never trained a dog to do that. How exciting. But thankfully, common sense prevailed. And I said, we'll all go to jail if we are successful. So as you can see, when you work with dogs, life is never boring. Over the many years, I've worked with dogs that will pee on your bed, dogs that bark all day, even dogs that bite people. But in all these cases, I've noticed there's a common thread. There is a serious lack of communication between the dog and the human. You see, the dogs, they're talking to us, and we humans aren't listening. Dogs have their own very beautiful language of communication. And it isn't just about the woofs and the yaps and the barks. They also use subtle body language signals. A turn of the head, a wag of the tail, a lick of the nose. And so when we communicate with dogs, we need to read all the signals that the dogs give to us. So as you can see here, it looks like two dogs playing to you, doesn't it? But you see the small dog, how stiff the body language is. He's not very comfortable with the big dog. The big dog reads that, understands it, and even though he seems to be wagging his tail, it's an uncertain wag. And all the body language is very nervous. Eventually, the bigger dog gets the message and runs off. See, so much spoken without a word being said. Let's take a look at this dog. He's miserable being picked up. Look at the ears. Look at his face. He's so unhappy. And when he's finally put down, that stress gets to him, and he licks his nose. You take a look at that. And eventually, he pants. To us as behaviorists, that's a definite sign of a stressed-out dog. The same dog, when I hug him, and remember, dogs don't like being hugged. And this dog lets me know that loud and clear. See the stiffness and see the licking of his nose. See how much dogs communicate without a word being said. Similarly, in the human world, we too communicate with body language. Let's take a look at some pictures to see what I mean. Do I need to go any further? Look at the turning away of the head. Just the body language says so much, right? What about this picture? Goodness, I can feel the tension standing here. Look at the crossed arms, the leaning forward. I'd have loved to have been a fly on the wall for that meeting. I bet you can all read loud and clear what's going on in this picture. Can't we? See how much better we would communicate with each other if we learned to listen to the unspoken language that we all speak. When you work with dogs, you get a chance to meet and be inspired by some amazing human beings. This is Karan and Mihir, brothers, best friends. Both were afflicted with spinal muscular atrophy at a young age. It's a progressive disease where the person afflicted tends to have weak muscle tone, feeding, breathing problems. Mihir was just 14. when the disease claimed him. He left without as much as saying goodbye. And Karan went into deep shock, and that soon spiraled into depression and hatred towards the whole world, until a little angel came into his life. And Karan approached me to train Angel to become an assistance dog. Assistance dogs are trained to help their partner lead a life of independence by carrying out physically challenging tasks. Angel is trained to fetch a phone when it rings. If Karan drops an object, he can't bend over and pick it up. Angel will do that for him. One of the things Karan struggles with day to day is when he comes home, he can't take off his socks. Angel helps him. She can also bring his mother in case of an emergency. She'll go and fetch help. She can open a drawer, pick up items and give them to Karan, and even put them back in. Angel even opens doors for Karan. It's among many of the commands that Angel does for Karan. But more than these physical tasks, Angel has given Karan a reason to wake up every day with a smile on his face. She's given him confidence. And Karan today spends his extra time volunteering at a shelter for street dogs. And the dogs there love him. Because dogs don't look at appearances. They look for kindness within. And it's not that we don't know these lessons, but sometimes it takes a dog to come into our life to remind us about them. At 8:46 a.m., on the 26th of January, 2001, the town of Bhuj in Gujarat met with a devastating earthquake. At that time, my husband and I, we had two dogs trained in search and rescue. These dogs are trained to use their noses to help locate people who are lost. So we bundled them into a van and we drove all the way from Bombay to Gujarat. Nothing in life would have prepared me for what I saw over there. We were taken to a place where a building had collapsed. And there was a chance that there were survivors there. And when we got there, my heart sank. What was supposed to have been a building was now just a two-story high pile of rubble. There was twisted metal, broken glass, bloodied clothes everywhere. But the two dogs, they rose to the occasion. Not once did they complain. Not once did they stop working. Not once did they lose hope. And there must have been about 100 people watching them work that day, everybody with a prayer on their lips. But unfortunately, after a few hours, we had to call off the search. We couldn't find anybody alive. And I remember when I put the leashes on the dogs and we were taking them back to the van. And as I was going there, this group of people came rushing towards me. And for a second, I panicked. I said, they're going to hurt us because we haven't managed to help them. And then one man reached into his pocket and he pulled out money. And he said, please take this for your services. There was a little boy in torn clothes and tear stains on his cheeks. And he had a little packet of biscuits. And he said, can I feed these to your dogs? And I looked at him and said, that must have been the only food you've had to eat all day. You want to give it to the dogs? There was a woman in a sari, and she wet the end of it, and she said, can I clean their feet? That's the least I can do for what they've done for us. And I looked at these people with tears in my eyes, and I said, you've lost everything. Some of you've lost family. Some of you've lost your homes. You've lost possessions. And here, you want to help dogs? And I know that thing one day. Our dogs may not have found survivors, but they brought out compassion in people. They brought out gratitude. They brought out hope in people who had lost everything. When I first started working in this field, people told me, it's a waste of time. Why do you want to work with dirty animals like dogs? Indian women can't train dogs. You are going to fail. But I'm glad I'm a very stubborn person. and I chose to ignore everybody because some of my best lessons in life have been taught to me by dogs. When you leave this auditorium today, you will be among the few people in the world who know how to listen, not just to dogs, but to humans as well. And with what you've learned today, I hope you never look at a dog the same way again or ever misunderstand what a person is trying to say to you. Because I truly believe this world has so much to tell us and to teach us. We only have to learn how to listen. Thank you.